Welcome to Better, the podcast about doing better, being better, and leaving the world a better place than we found it. What's going on, everybody? Welcome to Better. Jay, your host, as always. I should get a guest host. Not Luna. I should get a guest host of some sort so you guys don't have to see me all the time, because that'd probably be good. I wanted to get a female co-host at one point for the episodes I do by myself. However, I couldn't find anybody in this little shit town of mine. So if you live in Winnipeg and you happen to watch this and you're female and you like to talk and you think you have je ne sais quoi, hit me up, because I would love to have a co-host that did some things. And I like to put out more episodes when I'm not available. Okay, so this is part two of this episode, and this episode here. One second, I'm gonna bring this up. So this is two girls with cancer. I'm talking to them, to Becky and Ashley, and they have 8 episodes up currently of their podcast on YouTube, Spotify, and Apple Podcasts. Yeah, wow, brain fart. You guys should check it out. Because I know that they would probably love to steal some audience from here and take it over there, and then maybe vice versa. I don't know if people that are tuning into their podcast would want to tune into this one. Maybe, who knows. One quick housekeeping item for you guys before we get into the part two of the interview. You guys, a bunch of you messaged me to ask me what is my sleep regimen, because you guys know that I've had a bad insomnia my whole life. I got it under control. Then I went into the hospital. It's not under control currently, but I'm starting to lock it in again, and I'm starting to figure it out. So what I'm doing currently right now for my sleep is 4 hours before sleep, popping some magnesium. And then there's a product that's called HBC. It's a product you can get from Popeyes if you're in Canada, or probably any supplement store. But pop 4 of those. It's a de-stressor. Even if you're not stressed out, it's not really for like your cognitive acute stress. It's more for your compound stress or your body stress. I do, depending on how awake I am, I'll do, man, I'm raspy today. I don't know what's going on with the raspiness. I'll do 1 or 2, Diablo PM drinks. They taste like grape. They're delicious. And then I will do 2 to 3 gummies from Thrive. They're sleep gummies. Right now I'm also doing Tylenol 3, but that I don't recommend that. I will often sleep with a mask on with Bluetooth and sound storms or whatever is in my head. And then if I'm feeling super, if I've got the time for it, I will hot tub or sauna before about 4 hours before bed. I recommend starting your regimen 4 hours before bed, because if you do it like an hour or half an hour before and you find something interesting, you're gonna end up fighting against this tired and trying to stay awake, and it's gonna end up screwing everything up for you. It's gonna lead to a bad night's sleep. Right now my watch is telling me, which I'm not wearing, but my watch is telling me I'm getting anywhere from 5 to 8 hours, which is record-breaking for me. 3 weeks ago, I was averaging about 45 minutes a week. So big improvement. And this is very similar to the regimen I had Q3, Q4 of last year, where I got it really figured out. So, I will put it in the show notes, everything that I do for sleep, but it's really easy. Basically 4 hours before, magnesium and heat. I don't work out anymore before bed. That's a very key one. That one is actually keeping me awake. Diablo PM drinks, grape drink, and no T3s for you guys unless you're in pain. Okay, so that out of the way, let's bring our guests back in right now. Here, 1 second. Becky and Ashley, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm good. I don't know if you wanted to show people this, but I didn't even know that you're telling me it really helps you. Your donut. Can you show your donut? No, it's cool. Like anything that can help people get better, right?
Oh god.
I was making fun of her for having a donut and now I'm sitting on a pillow because my bum also had a donut.
I should get a cover for it, but
my great grandma had one of these.
And now I have one.
What does it do? It's just the softness helps.
Because from being in the hospital, being like in the bed laid out all the time, I messed up my tailbone. So it takes the pressure. I also don't have a big butt. So my doctor told me
very
I need to.
Small butt.
She's like, you need to get more butt muscle. I'm like, I can't even work out, Reed. So I have a donut. So it just stops the pressure off your tailbone. And it honestly, if I'm sitting in a chair for an hour without this, I can't even get up. Like I'm, you know, but as soon as I'm using this, I'm okay. It's a world of difference.
There's also those yoga pants that have the fake butt in them. Maybe you try that. I don't know.
My goal is once I'm back at her, I'm going to get it.
I have a big butt and my butt also hurts sitting on the ground. So I don't know.
Oh, so the natural cushion is not enough. You should get a donut too.
My tailbone needs to be cushioned, but then I would look like a bit of a.
It's like only $14.99 on Amazon.
Perfect. Everyone get a donut.
Everyone should.
You guys got your podcast name is Two Girls with Cancer and Donuts. That's what you should add in when you both get your donuts. And get themed donuts.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah.
Donut sponsor. Call us.
That'll be your first merchandise item will be a donut.
With our branding on it. Love it.
That's actually really good.
I mean, if it's things that we use and love, then
I swear by my donut.
I'm a big believer in only endorsing things that work. You know, I don't know how, like sometimes I listen to a podcast and I, you know, David Duchovny has a podcast and he's like talking about, he's like, I don't even drive these types of cars. I don't know why I'm even doing this, but they're awesome. Apparently. I'm like, wow, that's, first of all, that's not a great way to advertise. And second of all, why would you advertise something you don't believe in? I don't know. Seems weird.
Crazy. What can I ask? What's his podcast about? I'm watching X-Files right now. And I love it.
So is it your first time watching X-Files?
No, I would watch it as a kid. My parents would watch it. And I just remember being so scared and sitting there being like, why am I here? And so I stopped watching it once I hit like 10, probably. So now we're watching it again, facing my fears.
I would love, because I've watched it. I watched it as an adult again. Yeah. And I would love to, like, I have a friend who had never watched it before. And how do you spell his last name again?
Duchovny, I believe.
Yeah, there we go. Where is his podcast? I'm looking for it to get the name. But I'm so jealous of anybody that in their adult life watches X-Files the first time, because it's such a, like, it's pretty campy at times, but you watch it as a kid, you really don't get it.
No.
Scary.
Yeah, there's a lot of adult jokes in it, actually. I don't know why I can't find his podcast on YouTube.
I said to my husband the other day when we were watching it, and I was like, it's very interesting, some of the stuff that they're saying. Like, they're basically outing the U.S. government for hiding all kinds of things that I don't think that they would talk about now. But in the early 90s, you could get away with a lot more, I think. Less censorship. Yeah. And I thought that's interesting for a mainstream program.
Yeah, no, for sure. His podcast is called Fail Better.
Fail Better. Okay.
Yeah. So he basically has people on and they talk about failure and how to do it and rise from it and all that sort of thing. So
cool.
Yeah. I can't believe I can't remember the name considering the fact that half of the name is my
name. You're going to say it sounds a lot like your name.
Yeah. Except I don't really, well, we deal a little bit in failure, but more trying to deal in successes.
Success hopefully. Better.
Yes. Okay. So first episode, if you guys haven't watched it, go back. It kind of talks a little bit about their journey, how it started. But you guys, so my dad's widow, she was heavy into the natural side of things. It didn't go so well for her, but it did go well for you guys. You both went the natural path, kind of, yes, along with allopathic care. So I find a lot of people think that allopathic care or naturopathic care, they're divided. You have to do one or the other. You can't do both. because one is like, you know, if you're in the cult of natural care, it's allopathic. All the doctors are just trying to kill you, you know? And then if you're in the cult of allopathic care, it's like anything. I've lost so many friends recently over supplements, you know, because they're like, that's, you're selling snake oil. I'm like, no, I'm not. Like, I'm telling you guys what works for me. And if you decide to do it, fine. If you don't, whatever. I mean, I personally don't really care. But okay, so you guys did both, which I'm really excited about because I wish more people would do this. And I wish hospitals would actually do this where you had allopathic and natural care more so combined. So walk me through your treatments from allopathic and natural and what you did and at what stage in your treatments and all that.
Sure. Do you want to go or do you want me to go? This is more, mine's just the one.
So I definitely was in the cult of naturopathic fire. I absolutely believed that doctors did not care and they were trying to kill me. So what a humbling, what a humbling experience it was to get cancer for that. So in 2010, my ex-husband now, but his sister had passed away from breast cancer. And I watched her go through it. I watched them really fail her as a patient. They just kept forgetting to give her scans. Every time she would feel a pain, get a scan, find out the cancer had spread, they would literally say, oh, whoops, like we forgot to check that kind of thing. And so they failed her and she died at 25 years old. So I didn't have a great idea of, well, breast cancer, that's for sure. I didn't see any faith whatsoever, or had no faith in the system. And I remember my mother-in-law saying, like, I wish we had taken her to Mexico. You know, I wish we had just done it. The cancer center here had convinced them that she was going to get the best care here, not to go to Mexico. And my mother-in-law really regretted that. So I had said for the last 13 years, like, if I ever get sick, I'm going to Mexico. And so of course, when I got sick, I was like, let's do it. We're going to Mexico. Well, my husband did not like that idea. His mom had had breast cancer 10 years earlier. And, you know, she went the regular route. She was a nurse. So, you know, she trusted the healthcare system. She did it as traditionally as possible or as conventionally as possible. And so him and I were really at odds with it. Like he was dead set on us not spending any money since we're in Canada. And, you know, me doing the chemo, doing the surgery. And so we, you know, really thought about it. And I ended up in Mexico a month after, or 5 weeks after diagnosis. And the first day that I got there, my doctors in Mexico told me that I needed chemo. And I was like, no, like, how can this be? I've come all the way here. But the type of breast cancer that I had, it was called HER2 positive. And there's a drug called Herceptin that is very, very responsive, or the cancer is very responsive to it. I think it came out in the early 2000s, and prior to that drug coming out, HER2 positive cancer was a death sentence. And then as soon as they came out with this immunotherapy type drug, it like changed it. And so now they say, if you're going to get a breast cancer, HER2 is the one to get. So, you know, I was very thankful for that. So I agreed to do a low dose chemo in Mexico, along with all of the holistic care. So basically when I say low dose, it's not the 100% potency like it is here. It's, I think, 30%, they said, and they give it with insulin. So they drop your blood sugar real low and then they spike it with glucose after. And the reason for that is when cancer cells are hungry, they're going to eat anything. Like normally they eat sugar, right? They love glucose. And so if you starve them, if you fast them, this is why a lot of people do long-term fasting for diseases, because, you know, the disease can't eat anything when there's no sugar or no carbohydrates in your body. But anyway, so they drop your blood sugar really low, and then the cancer just wants to eat anything. So as soon as that glucose hits your body again, the cancer is going to just start chomping down, and it's going to eat all that chemo really fast. So I saw a lot of progress with that. By the time, like the 4 weeks that I did in Mexico, all of the tumors in the breast itself were completely gone. The only thing that was left was the lymph nodes. And like the lymph nodes are obviously important because that's what makes it stage 3, is in your lymph nodes. But while I was there, I also did IV treatment every day. So I had multivitamins. I did DMSO, which is for inflammation. It helps bring down the inflammation. I did chelation therapy, which is for heavy metal detoxing. I did sodium bicarbonate, which is to create alkalinity in your body because cancer loves an acidic environment. And I did glutathione, which is your body's master antioxidant. It's the most powerful antioxidant in your body. So I had those bags. They had come up with a routine for me. So every day, 6 days a week, I would go in and do these treatments. And then once a week, I would do the low dose chemo. So I did 4 weeks there. I came back. And I had talked to my surgeon. I said, hey, I just did chemo and I went to Mexico, and he was very angry with me. And he, you know, told me basically that I just wasted 2 months of my life, and that because of it, he wasn't going to, you know, be cautious with the conservative with my surgery. He was just going to take everything and not give me an MRI to see the progress that I've had. And I thought, screw this guy, I'm going back to Mexico. So I did. I went back for another 2 weeks, and I thought for sure like everything was going to be completely gone from 6 weeks of treatment. And I came back, I got a new surgeon. He did the MRI and saw that the lymph nodes were still there. So I really had to decide what was I going to do. I was out of money at this point. I'd already spent 40 grand Canadian. So I'd also had surgery too while I was there. I had a lymph node taken out, and they had turned it into a tumor vaccine. So it was an oral vaccine, just an immunotherapy type thing. So, you know, as I'm ingesting my own tumor, my body recognizes that we don't want that and we're going to fight it. So I did that while I was there as well. And so, yeah, when I came back, I really wrestled with the idea, like, what am I going to do? I have to try and find more money. I have to go back down. Do I do surgery here? Because in Canada, it's free. In Mexico is going to cost another 10 grand to have a mastectomy. And I didn't know. And I finally decided, like, let's just do chemotherapy in Canada. I've done, you know, all the natural, I'm on all kinds of things at this point. I came home with like a stash of supplements and vitamins, and I thought, okay, let's do it. Let's do chemo. And I'm not going to have any symptoms from it. I'm going to be totally healthy and totally fine. And obviously not the case. I lost my hair pretty quickly. And yeah, so I did six rounds of that, and it was very tough. But looking back, I actually think I sailed through it. And I believe the reason for that is because I had jacked up my body on the holistic stuff. And I think I actually would have done even better if I had stayed doing those things during chemo. The cancer center, they set you up with a pharmacist right before you start, and they assess everything that you're on and tell you what you can stay on and what you can't stay on. And they pretty much made me get off of everything. So the only things I was allowed to stay on was ivermectin, which my Mexican doctors had put me on. And ivermectin is for parasites. And I think that was the only thing. Like, I had been on like a high dose vitamin C drink and vitamin A, like curcumin for inflammation. And what else was I on? B17, which is not actually a B vitamin. It's a cyanide. And I was giving myself shots of that. And I was on baby aspirin because people with cancer are prone to get blood clots. And yeah, I was on like a whole host of things. They just took me off of everything. And I wish that I had stayed on most of them throughout it. But anyway, yeah, I did the chemo and kind of sailed through it. Looking back, like, my nails didn't fall off. I lost my hair, but I wasn't completely bald. I had like just a ton of peach fuzz. I didn't lose my eyebrows and my eyelashes till the very last round. And even still, they didn't go away 100%. And then, you know, within like days of finishing chemo, all my hair started to grow back again. And now I have actually quite a bit of it under my wig. And yeah, what else? Yeah, I took like 6 weeks of a break after chemo. I actually went to Mexico, had a little vacation with my family. And then I did the mastectomy. And during this time, I started seeing a naturopath, and I was doing high dose vitamin C. And it wasn't just vitamin C, it was all kinds of things, magnesium and acetylcysteine and gosh, like a million other things. And my body reacted so poorly to it. Like, I went through a Herxheimer reaction, if you know what that is, like a healing crisis. Yeah. And I actually thought that I had brain metastasis. Like, it was that bad. I went to the emergency room thinking that I had brain cancer, and it was so stressful. And this was 3 days before or 4 days before my mastectomy was supposed to happen, and ended up having a bunch of scans and nope, they couldn't see anything. So it ended up just being a healing crisis. And so I ended up starting taking binders, a bit of charcoal in water or bentonite clay in water, and that binded up all the toxins flying around. And then I felt fine after. And yeah, then I had the mastectomy, and then I took another 6 week break where I was just hitting my supplements hard at home. And then I started radiation as well. So a real big mix of everything. And now that the treatment's done, it finished, well, the radiation finished in February. I've just continued to see my naturopath, and I take microvitamin shots from him now that I can't really handle those big vitamin bags. And yeah, I have a whole stash here. A little bit of a detox program that I'm on, and then things for my liver like milk thistle. And we were saying before the show, I do coffee enemas pretty frequently, which is...
Oh, that was real. I thought you were joking.
Oh, no. I love coffee enemas. Yeah. You know what? I'm not going to tell you what to do, but like the days that I'm having a lot of pain, just because I think my muscles have really... atrophied since having chemo and, you know, just not using my muscles. The days that I'm in a lot of pain, I will do the coffee enemas daily, and then that pain subsides.
What's the active ingredient that helps with that?
Coffee. No, it's because it's a liver detox. So, you know, most enemas are a colon detox. This is a liver detox. And so when you're cleaning out your liver, it's actually creating glutathione. And I think they say for every coffee enema that you do, you're creating 700% more glutathione in your body. So
how does a coffee enema do that?
I don't know. I wish I knew the science behind it, but I look into it. I'll send you as much info as I can possibly find. Oh, we're doing it. We're going to Google.
We're going. Yeah. Okay. So,
now the thing about this is like what you had talked about, allopathic and naturopathic, they quite often don't mesh. And the reason being is because people are so polarized when it comes to it. People believe in one and not the other. And I remember going to the hospital on another emergency room trip and telling them that I did coffee enemas and them grilling me on it. Like, why would I do something so stupid? So, and I mean, Google, again, as a conspiracy theorist, I do think that Google is a hard place to find good information. I mean, you have to look, it is there, but.
Well, this is a great time to jump into a quick conversation I've been wanting to have with everybody. And I want to do it as a separate episode, and I will. So my career and my education has always forced me to be a good researcher. Mm-hmm. So if anybody has ever looked at, let me see here. Give me 1 second, guys. Just type it in. If you're listening, we're just going through some stuff here on Google. Okay, so this is what is called the evidence pyramid. And so essentially what this is, let me just blow it up a little bit so everybody can see it. This is from the bottom to the top, the bare minimum to the absolute maximum you can get in terms of information and how credible information is. Mm-hmm. So if you're living in the US right now, everything in the US defies this pyramid. It's like evidence and meta-analysis and all this is not something that people really believe in right now in the US for some reason. So for some reason, I'm not going to put the name to it, but there's a reason. So essentially, if you use this pyramid and you look at all information as this pyramid, you'll be able to verify the credibility of information very easily. So if you go to to here, so the great thing about, I know people dog the NIH all the time, but the great thing about NIH is that if you go look, like if we look at the safety and, I got to go to the actual window. 1 sec here. If you go and look at the safety and effectiveness of self-administered coffee enemas. So if you go and you're looking at the article, the wonderful thing is links to all the people that wrote it. So it's not like some random reporter and all these sorts of things. You got your author information, you got your article notes, which are very important because it's easy to digest the information through your through the article notes, your copyright and your license information. So that allows you to know if people are filing copyrights and licensing information on the article, chances are that means that it's verified information. Your abstract, which is very important to understand. You got your introduction, you go through all your information, and then you get to the bottom, and the bottom is your references. So you can go and you can go on like this crazy infinite journey of trying to verify the information. So you can manage to, God, I'm so raspy. What is going on today? It's really weird. I'm not usually this raspy. Do I sound raspy to you guys?
We have nothing to really compare it to because we've never talked in person before. But
listened to my podcast before? Oh my God!
I don't think you sound raspy at all.
Okay, good. So that's a great way to find information. So you guys will notice that, like, I blew this up right when she was talking about it, and I immediately went to it. And you're probably thinking, like, oh, went to the first source. However, I'm very aware of the way that they rate their documents, so the PMC number and all that, it all gives you, it allows you to trust the information. So according to the reports, coffee enema was effective for relieving constipation as caffeine increased the intestinal mobility when absorbed in the intestinal mucosa? Mucosa? Mm-hmm. How do I not know that mucosa. Word?
Yeah.
Mucosa, and decreasing lipids and cholesterol, as well as improving thyroid function. So that makes sense as to why it works for what you're going through with pain and everything, right? Because I just want to bring that up because that was a good introduction to be able to give people, because people have a really hard time with real information these days, right? So that makes sense, okay, that it works like that. Now I'm very anti-caffeine personally. I know you're probably gonna think this is insane. I've never had a drop of coffee ever in my life.
Oh wow.
Yeah. I haven't drank since I was 15 years old. Wow. Except for one time when my friends got me drunk and I thought it was just drinking shitty bar Coke, but they were spiking my drinks.
Wow.
Yeah, I ended up having to go to the Hell's Angels clubhouse and apologize to them because I should never drink. But that's interesting. A coffee enema.
Mm-hmm. So if you look into the Gerson therapy, that's a doctor from the early 1900s, and he passed away and then his daughter took over. And so a lot of the clinics in Mexico follow the Gerson therapy. You can go to a Gerson clinic down there, and it's really big on juicing. And the thing too, like, you don't just do the coffee enema, like, you have to supplement after because you're obviously expelling so many electrolytes. So you need to get, I believe it's 2,500 milligrams of potassium, and I think it's 600 of magnesium after. So anytime I do a coffee enema, I juice after and supplement with magnesium, and, you know, eat a whole bunch of bananas and stuff.
Okay. Well, that's good. Mm-hmm. I honestly, my mom's going through a lot of pain right now. So.
Wear an enema bucket.
Yeah. Maybe this is the recommendation. Well, let's get some verified studies going on here. You guys are the first study now. Do you do it as well, or is it just you? Do you both do it?
I'm going to start. I haven't. I've just been doing the saltwater enema.
Okay. See, mine is joint and nerve. Mm-hmm. So I don't know that it would do much for me because there's not a lot that can actually be done for those things. And because mine's so extreme, I don't think it'll help. But definitely, it sounds like it would be good for her, so I'll recommend it to my mom. And then you said you only do one thing, supplement wise.
I only do the holistic because, when they told me that I had cancer and is stage 4 or whatever, they pretty much said, like, the oncologist, I didn't see him until 4 months after. And my surgeon at the time, she's like, don't be afraid if he tells you that there's no treatment options for you. I'm like, what? I was like, I have cancer. What? I don't go chemo? Like, I don't get chemo or radiation? What are you talking about? I was so mad. And then, so then I went to my appointment, and there's, for the type that I have, there's, and where I was, there was no preventative measures, like, going forward. There was no treatment for me at the time. And there isn't, until this cancer hits one of my major organs, there's three different treatments that they have. I guess it'd be chemo radiation mix. I'm not quite sure exactly what
it is. Probably they would start at chemo, guessing.
But if it has to hit a major organ, and then that's if your body takes to the treatments. So they don't really give you a time, but so in my mind, like when I left that appointment, I knew I wasn't feeling well still. And I was talking to my brother-in-law and he suggested the live blood analysis because I really didn't know what I was going to do. I was told to walk away and carry on with your life and I might
don't die
pretty much. And I was like, that wasn't good enough for me. I had my baby. And for me, I was like, I need to fight this. I could have like crumbled to my diagnosis, but I knew that there was more for me in life and I wasn't ready to go. So then my brother-in-law was like, we need to get your blood live analysis. I've never heard of this in my life, never. Because you go to your doctors and they get your blood, they take, you know, they tell you where you're at, your levels and stuff like that. So for me, I was like, what is this? And I was like, okay, I'll give it a try. And of course you have to pay out of pocket. When I went to get it done, because after the surgeries, I never felt well, you know, like, you know, when there's something wrong with your body. Mm. And so when we went, it's pretty cool, like, to watch your blood alive and on a screen. But she found, like I was saying in the first episode, microscopic parasites. So once they get that, they're all over your body. And I was invested in them. And then the heavy metals, mold, fungus, blood clots, and the liver was failing. So after we had gotten my blood clean, took about 4 months, I had to really figure out, I had to do so much research to what I needed to do for my liver, because diseases can't live in your body if your liver is functioning. So I had to do my liver. I wanted to make sure I didn't have yeast or mold. So I do so many different things. Now I have a lot of supplements. My main ones, like I do Celtic sea salt because it actually draws the water into your organs and into your body. I do that one. That's one of my favorites. I also do a lot of juicing. That is probably my main thing that I do, because especially from losing half my colon, it's really caused a lot of issues with eating and my stomach blowing up. So the easiest way for me to get my nutrients is by juicing. So I have about, I don't know, 50 supplements. I Googled what herbs kill cancer cells. So I'm on saffron, turmeric, oil of oregano, black seed oil. Like I take a ton of stuff, you know, because for me it's working. Like I don't have active cancer right now, but I have to be consistent. I think the hardest thing for me is, even when I'm tired and have bad days, I still got to juice. I still have to make sure I'm getting enough protein that my body needs. I have to make sure I got my supplements in, you know. It's a battle every day, but it gets easier, I guess.
Just get used to it. It's like a routine all of a sudden.
What's that?
But it just becomes a routine. Like you don't want to do it. It just is, right?
Yeah, I had a lot of friends that make fun of me because I had a toolkit that was for my supplements. And I do this thing now called Thrive. It's a little bit of a different kind of supplement thing. Like it's am I wearing it on here? Where do I have? Oh, I have it on my hip right now.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, so there's a patch you put on, and it releases the vitamins throughout the day. And then you got your multivitamin in the morning. You got your prebiotic, your probiotic, and your protein shake, and then like a bunch of other stuff as well. They got lots of great products, but I condensed down because I was like, God, I got so many supplements. It's just like, it's so much. Like it took me 45 minutes every morning to do all my shakes and all my supplements. I'm like, gee, this is insanity. So I've cut it down a lot. But you know, important for everybody that's listening to this is supplements are very individual. So for some people, the supplements that I take, some of them work for me, like all of them work for me. But I know like when I started my supplement journey, I took one on at a time because I wanted to see what would work and what wouldn't. And I cut a lot of stuff out that just didn't work for me. Doesn't mean it doesn't work. Just means it didn't work for me.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then there's the other problem with the supplement industry is there's a lot of shitty supplements out there. So you got to kind of figure out, like, when you look at something, it's like 250-1 water based to like, you know, you're like, oh, so I'm basically drinking water here. Like, that's basically what I'm getting. So that, you know, and that there's a lot of snake oil out there. But on this topic, if you guys want, they're listening right now, if you want someone to follow that offers really great, straight, no bullshit advice on Instagram, go follow this guy. I got to do that in this window here. So this guy, Dr. James. So this post, I love, the greatest performance enhancers of all time, salt and electrolytes, lifting weights, 8 to 10K steps, running, cycling, 8 to 10 hours of sleep, high protein diet, cold showers, creatine and collagen, coffee and sunshine. I don't follow you on the coffee thing, but that's that. Okay. His whole account. What's that?
He means coffee in here. That's what he means.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I really like the way he delivers health advice. Like, it's he's a doctor and he delivers it super simple and right to the point. And he loves to talk about how, you know, like, the government has like their recommendations for diet and everything. And he's like, this is ridiculous. Like, some of the stuff they'll come up with. Right. So, like, right now they're recommending not to eat eggs. Like, you know, yeah, it's so insane. So if you guys get a chance, go check out and follow him.
So, can I say something about that?
Yeah.
I don't want to interrupt you. So I was on a breast cancer diet call fairly recently, the last couple months. Our cancer center put it on, and I thought, hey, why not? Like, why not learn something new? And some of the things that they were saying in this call were, in my opinion, offensive, because I thought it was so, uneducated. Like, they were saying that in Canada, you don't actually have to worry about buying organic versus non-organic because there's no link to pesticides causing cancer, and that you definitely don't need to have unvaccinated or organic meat because they don't give any vaccinations to any animals other than beef. And I can't remember what else they were saying. Yeah, that you don't really even need meat in your diet. You just, as long as you're getting like a plant protein, you're fine. So I just thought that was sort of a negligent conversation to have. And for me, like, I'm fairly well researched in this. And I thought, like, what about these people who aren't well researched in it? And they hear, oh, okay, I don't have to worry about anything I put in my body. Like, when I think that, you know, I think the reason that a lot of people are getting cancer now is because how crappy our food is, like, because how environmental. Yeah. If you're not eating whole foods, and if you're eating like very processed foods and overly medicated animals, like, you're going to get sick. So that's my opinion.
Well, the thing about allopathic care is that a lot of doctors, they go to school, let's say, doctors right now went to school in the 70s and they really just stop learning.
Yeah.
Like, they go to school, they get their MD, they get to be called a doctor, and then they just continue on until they retire with that information. The problem now is that with AI and quantum computing coming in, everything, the amount of problems they're going to be able to solve in the next 10 years that we don't even know are problems yet are going to be, it's going to be bananas. The whole, like, people think that the world changed a lot from the 80s to now. From 2024 to 2034, we're not even going to recognize the world. It's going to be so different. And doctors are going to have to figure out how to deal with that. It's kind of like school. You know, when we went to school, you got a textbook. And that was probably the same textbook that the classes 30 years before us got, with maybe a couple rewrites. Now, a lot of the better schools, everything's on an iPad, and as information changes in science and everything, they update it so that it's always new, right? And then they tell
my kids definitely don't have textbooks, that's for sure.
Yeah, so they, you know, this is another way that, like, it's not that they're intending to do wrong, it's that they don't even know they're doing wrong because they're going off of old information. And at some point, they're going to have to come around to the way things are. I don't even know, honestly. I think we're going to have so much information in the next 10 years that we're going to have access to when quantum computing hits, that I don't even know how the hell we're going to even digest it.
Like, I, for me, with the form of cancer that I have had and continue to have, there's like barely any research on it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I was just left in the dark to just carry on with life, you know? And it's like, yeah. Really? You know,
it's very under-researched.
It is. And like every cancer is different. And a lot of people don't, like we talked about, they don't understand that, you know? Yeah. And it's, I wish that they would put everything into all of them. And I know that's a lot to say or ask for, but it would give me more hope. Like when it came to like my diet, it's like, well, what do I eat? What do I have to cut out? Well, nothing. We're fine. And I'm like, that doesn't make sense to me. It's like, I just lost my insides and you're going to tell me I'm fine. Just carry on with everything I'm doing. And literally when I asked, he pretty much told me, yeah, carry on. If you want to have a drink, have a drink. If you want to do this, do that. You know? And I'm like, what? This makes no sense to me.
Live exactly as you were living and hope that it doesn't come back.
That's what I was told. Yeah. So that was like, that's why it was, I go down, like I'm up and down with this because it's, I really got nothing to work on.
Yeah.
It's a hard, you know, and like when we'll hashtag our cancers, there's so much more on.
Oh, there's millions for breast cancer and there's like 10,000 for neuroendocrine cancer.
It's barely out there.
And that's, yours is not as glamorous as breast cancer.
But it sure messed me up.
Yeah.
But I think that's another reason we wanted to do our podcast is because we want to share that there are two different, like we have two completely different cancers, you know? Yeah. And we just want to be able to help as many people. Maybe if someone has my cancer and they've never heard of it, or, you know, there is just hope out there for people.
Can you send me a resource that you find, or a couple resources you find that are good for your cancer so I can put them in the show notes?
Sure.
Do you know the numbers on like how many people get, is your cancer like super rare or what's, why very is it rare. Not?
It's very super rare. I don't know the stats on it. I guess that's something I can look up.
I actually know a lady who just passed away from the same cancer, although I don't know if hers originated in the appendix. I'd have to find out more.
I think that. The most common place is the liver.
Oh, I'm pretty sure. Interesting.
But I'm not sure. Like even my one doctor, he had it's starting to get more common, I guess. Like my family doctor was like, oh yeah, he had somebody, but he didn't end up passing away until about 10 years later from the cancer. So, I mean, there's hope.
But I wonder if he did any of the things that you do, right?
Maybe not.
Like if he was just living his life, having the drinks and eating whatever he wanted, you know,
that wasn't good enough. I couldn't do that. I couldn't walk away and be like, okay, let's just continue on. Like, I thought I was healthy before. I meal prepped, I lived a healthy lifestyle, I worked out, I trained, but it wasn't enough.
There's some super basic stuff that I can't believe. Like, it's 2024, we're still smoking and drinking alcohol. Like, it just blows my mind that there's like this really basic stuff that we all know, right? Mm-hmm. Nobody is like, nobody that smokes, I've told the story before, but I'll tell it again. So I was in California and my buddy goes to Stanford. And so he's like, Bill Gates is talking. I'm like, what? Oh my God, I want to go see this, right? So he's got friends in the administration, gets me in. I go to this Bill Gates speech. It's in this huge auditorium. And he asked for the top students in the school, the best and the brightest, the smartest people in the school, that's who he wanted at this speech. So he gets on stage and he starts asking people questions. And one of the questions he asked is, do you smoke? And he got people to like shift around the room based on their answers. And he said, okay, all the people over here, you smoke, you need to leave. I asked for the best and the brightest. You're obviously not the best and the brightest. And it was so harsh and it was such a nail through their heart. Right. My buddy was telling me the next year that over half of those people quit smoking because of how harsh the message was, right?
But there's like, shame.
Yeah, it's total shame, right? But the interesting thing that he said to me was, he said, everybody knows what they shouldn't be doing.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to be in tune with yourself, which means you have to be smart enough to listen to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And to, you know, listen to the natural laws of the universe and the environment and everything. And to be able to execute on a lot of these things, right? Like I try to eat healthy, but I do enjoy pizza. Like I'm a foodie. I enjoy pasta and all those sorts of things, right? And in my head, I'm like, I know I shouldn't be eating this stuff. But then in my taste buds, I'm like, oh my God, I can't, how can I go to a Gordon Ramsay restaurant and not have like
everything? Beef right? Wellington.
Yeah. So, you know, but then you look at it, you're like, okay, so now, like you were saying, they're like, don't eat any meat. Right. And it's like, that was a pretty popular thing for a while. If you have cancer, mm-hmm. don't eat. Mm-hmm. But now like the research is coming around and it's like, cause people said that without research, I feel like there wasn't a lot of research to back that up. It was just kind of like a feeling that people had. Mm-hmm. But now they're starting to learn, like, it's not don't eat meat. It's don't eat the wrong meat.
Don't eat really terrible hormone filled vaccinated meat. I think part of it is that meat is, it creates acidity in your body, but like most conventional meat that you buy from the grocery store is full of absolute junk. So I think it's different. When I first got sick, I just cut out everything because I heard that same thing, like, be a raw vegan, that's how you're gonna live. And I hated it. My body hated it. I'm an O blood type. I need red meat. And so I started to integrate it back into my diet slowly, like little pieces of like wild caught organic, you know, or pasture raised or grass finished, like that kind of stuff. I would put back in my diet. And it helped big time. I just had the energy that I didn't have when I was only eating raw vegetables.
See, I never cut my meat out at all. No, I just cut out sugar. And I cut out gluten. And so I was juicing and I eat my meat. That's all sugar I did.
Sugar is the devil.
Yeah. I switched to monk fruit sweetener when I needed something.
Right.
It was fine.
I actually just had a food sensitivity test done with my naturopath because I thought I'm doing all these things, but I'm still having a lot of like gut pain. And I found out that I'm actually reacting to all sort of like healthy alternatives to sugar. So like cane sugar and maple syrup and agave and things like that, I'm reacting to that. So I'm basically allowed a little bit of honey and that's it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's a hard way to live in this day and age.
Mm-hmm.
Like to try to cut out sugar is next to impossible. Sugar's in everything.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The things that I were reacting to was dairy, yeast, and sugar. And it was like, what do I eat? Like literally just meat and vegetables and fruit. I didn't react to fruit. So those are don't get me wrong. I do eat fairly liberally just because there was for so long while I first got sick where I didn't eat any of that, where I was very clean. And then, you know, once chemo hits and you're just like, I just want to survive. Like, I do not give a shit like what I'm putting in my body. And then now I'm back at a stage where I'm like, okay, like you need to take care of yourself again. So kind of a balance between raw vegan and I don't care, I'm doing chemo.
Yeah, see, it's just amazing how different everybody is. Like, I feel like I get superpowers when I drink milk.
Mm.
Like, it's so good for me. It like I used to drink about 16 liters a week when I was a kid. So like when I moved out of my parents' place, the milkman was like, "Whoa, what happened? You know, like why are you only getting 4 liters a week now?" Like I had a fridge in my room for my milk. Like that's how much milk I drank, right? So. And I feel it when I get up in the morning. If I don't have a glass of milk, I kind of like, it's okay morning. If I have a glass of milk, it's like Popeye and spinach.
Mm.
It's crazy. I just like my whole body just comes alive when I drink milk.
Interesting.
But for some people, it's absolutely the worst thing for them.
Well, dairy is supposed to be quite inflammatory as well.
Yeah.
So to me, I'm hearing like if you have body pain and you're drinking a ton of milk, are you causing more inflammation in your body? I don't know.
So they tested it because I told them that, right? I told them and they were like, oh, we got to do all that. And no.
Interesting. So,
yeah, my body just responds to milk in a very positive way.
I love that. And that's cool.
They think maybe I actually I brute forced it, drinking as much as I did. Because your body can become dependent on almost anything, right? So, and if you're, and when you're a kid, like I've been drinking tons of milk from a very early age. So you're changing your body chemistry. Mm-hmm. And actually when I was in the hospital, they weren't bringing me milk. Mm. And I was like feeling really, and I said one day, I was like, please, I just want a glass of milk. Like, just bring me milk. Mm-hmm. And then my dad brought me one of those milk to go's and I downed it. And holy shit, what a difference. It was crazy.
I'm picturing now that you said Popeye, we used to like.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So what do you think, if you had to put a percentage to it, allopathic and natural, how much contribution did it make to your overall healing?
Well, for me, 50-50, because if I didn't get those surgeries, I would have died. Right. Because my clinic birth, right? So maybe even more than that. Maybe, I don't know, 60-40. You know, like, your appendix bursting on its own, you can die from,
mm-hmm.
right? Yeah. And to have this huge cancer tumor, it was like this big, 6.3 centimeters, and then it just spitting the cancer everywhere. Like, if I didn't go through those surgeries, I wouldn't be here.
Right. Mm-hmm. How about you? What do you think?
I mean, I want to lean more toward the naturopathic, but, you know, yeah, I did see some good results with the things, but it wasn't honestly until I did the chemo with the Herceptin that it really responded. So gosh, like I would say 75-25, and that pains me as someone who was so anti.
But you have to do it together. I'm big on, if you want to do the one, you want to do, you know, non-holistic, you have to add it in. They have to go together.
Mm-hmm.
You do.
Yeah. Well, there's so many side effects. Like I was just thinking too, when you were saying in your intro that, you know, you take your Tylenol 3s at night for pain. It's like, you know, what is that doing to your liver, or your kidneys, whichever one Tylenol affects, you know, like if it's the liver, like, you know, maybe you should be taking a milk thistle supplement with it to help provide liver support kind of thing. Right. It's like, there's so many side effects to pharmaceuticals that do so much damage. So I do think that they need to go hand in hand. You need to boost your immune system and support your organs and support your functioning so that the pharmaceuticals don't do nearly as much damage.
Because they're guinea pig right now. And the one that they put me on, it worked for about 3 weeks to about a month, and now it's not working. So I was like, you know what? I'm not going to take this anymore. Then when I was in the hospital and just the other day, they're like, well, we're going to put you on this drug. And I'm like, but you guys aren't finding the root cause. Mm-hmm. And you're just throwing these things at me. And I'm like, I'm just not going to do it. So I've decided I'm just going to go off everything, let my body reset, and then go from there and see if my body in about a month or two can figure itself out. Because it's painful. My stomach swells up to here. Like, it's huge. Wow. And it feels because I have my incisions from above my belly button to my groin. And they cut me open twice, and it literally feels like it's gonna split open.
Oh, wow, that'd be really
amazing. It is. And it's hard to explain because they don't find anything on images, so they don't know. They just keep saying, we don't know.
Wow.
So that's what I'm
Yeah, the weird thing about mine is that Tylenol 3 isn't even supposed to work for me.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been on like every medication imaginable trying to manage the pain. And supplements too, and everything. I tried milk thistle. I've pretty much tried everything at this point. And they were like, don't take Tylenol 3. It's going to do no good for you. And I was just, a couple weeks ago, I was just so much agony. So it's like, my mom has like so much Tylenol 3 because of, you know, it helps her sleep. She's got a lot of, because it was in her spleen. And, you know, like, laying down, what do you, like, you know. So. Yeah. So I was like, okay, I'm desperate. I'll try one. And what a difference. Just such a difference. So in combination with everything else, because you're right, you know, like pharmaceuticals can do a number on you. You need to make sure you're repairing from it as well. So yeah, I completely agree with that.
Well, it's look, fun. Like chemo is so hard on your body. Like you literally lose all your hair and your muscle mass. Your muscles are like jelly when you do it. Like it's so terrible for you. And yet it's a double-edged sword because it also gets rid of cancer. So, you know, we were talking about this, the when they administer the chemo, they gown up and they put gloves on. And I asked why. And they said, well, if it got on our skin, it could give us cancer. I was like, oh my God, like, why are you putting this into my body?
I was like,
So yeah, most, you have to support it.
I find most allopathic care, when like deep care, is a huge contradiction almost always. It's because, you know, it's like you see those ads where people say, well, this has this chemical in it, this ingredient, so it's toxic and it'll kill you. And it's like, well, the problem is that involvement is key, right? How much, you know, like if you got, you're fighting against cancer, so the cancer is doing this to your body, that ingredient combined with that ingredient actually is good for you. But then somebody who doesn't have cancer, it's bad for you, right? You got to put all this stuff in the con. I honestly, like, hats off to you guys, because balancing allopathic and natural care, going through all the research and trying to figure it out is like, what a nightmare.
It's exhausting.
There's so much information, so much bad information, right? And so much conflicting information. So it's like, how do you even, you know, the fact that you guys were both able to figure it out is pretty amazing, because a lot of people don't, right? So I don't know, like, I guess last thing I'll ask you guys is, so if somebody is right now is got either of your cancers, so you can both answer this question. You go, they went to the doctor, they got the exact same diagnosis as you guys. Now that you've been through the experience, what would be the couple things that you would recommend that they could potentially do, that they should talk to their doctor about and talk to whoever about, to see if it would work for them?
Well, I would say, like, first off, you can take a little bit of time. Like, the conventional treatment, it wants to rush you into making a decision, because to them, if you're not like medicated within the week, you're going to die. And so I think, like, take a little bit of time to really decide what you feel comfortable with. And then I would see a naturopath in the meantime. Like, that would be my, like, I mean, I went to Mexico, like, and I definitely stand by that. I probably could have done some stuff in Canada with a naturopath instead of going to Mexico. I guess it depends like what you want to spend. But yeah, I would do that. I would see a holistic practitioner first to really boost your immune system. Because if you're going to go do chemo radiation surgery, like, what a beating on your body. So, like, boost your immune system first. I mean, I feel like we all get sick because our immune system is not optimal, right? Like, it's not functioning the way it should be, or it's weakened. So boost it as best as you can so that you can fight it as best as you can.
How about you?
In mine, I would say, don't be scared when they tell you, you know, that there's no cure for it or they can't do anything. Keep advocating for yourself and find a holistic doctor. You know, where I was, you need that. And you do, you know, and get your blood, live blood analysis, get that testing done, because that will give you your baseline, what you need to do. You can figure out where you can go from there, what's in your blood, and then you can clean it out and figure out what works for you.
Okay. And the second part of that question, is there anything you'd recommend not doing? Again, everybody's an individual, but what would be something that you did? You're like, I really wish I hadn't done that.
I think, like, don't feel pressured by your doctor. Like I said, they will try to rush you into something. My doctor said, you have until the end of the week to make a decision. And then I didn't make a decision. And then he dropped me as a patient. And so, like, he didn't like that I went to Mexico. So he did not anyway. But yeah, don't feel rushed into it. If you don't feel comfortable doing something, don't. Like, I have a friend, her husband just went through this. He just found out that he had cancer in the throat. And his doctors were trying to push him into doing chemo. And he's like, I feel pretty strongly that I don't want to do that. And they were pushing and pushing. And then when they actually got in there to do surgery, they found that it was a tiny little tumor. They said it was like one of the smallest they've seen. And his surgeon said, like, you do not do chemo. Like, you absolutely do not. But the other doctors, like, really pushed for it. So just take some time. If you're a person who loves allopathic and you're on, what do you say, the allopathic cult side, go for it. Do the chemo. But, like, I don't know, take time before you rush into it.
Right. My biggest thing is, don't be bullied. Don't let them tell you how you feel. You know, like, you should be at this point, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's such a crazy journey, and it's so different for all of us. Each and every one of us, we're different. Our bodies are going to react differently. You know, don't let them tell you that you should be further along, you know, or stuff like that. Listen to your body and advocate. And if you don't feel comfortable with something, keep asking. Ask questions.
Okay. All right. Anything else you guys want to add before we go?
I think just be positive too. Like, it's very important to stay positive. Yeah, we're all gonna go down like a dark hole sometimes. Like, but don't stay there, because it is not good for growth. It's not good for just your outlook. If you feel like you're gonna die, well, you know, you're kind of, that's kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? You stay positive, you look toward the light, basically, and I think it really helps. That mindset is huge.
And make sure you cut out negative people. If they're not serving you, get them out of your life, because stress is going to make your body sicker. Is that a word? Sicker.
Yeah. Good point. Hang tight. I'm going to outro out the show. And by the way, as you guys know, a self-fulfilling prophecy is my biggest annoyance in life, because it is probably the saddest thing that we can do, is become a self-fulfilling prophecy. So I like that she said that at the end there, because you guys know how much I hate self-fulfilling prophecies. So it was a great talk with Becky and Ashley. I know everybody knows somebody that's going through cancer, or maybe you're going through cancer or whatever. Check out their podcast again. Let me pull up just so I've got it on the side. Oh, did I go away from it? I think I did, because I was researching David Duchovny here. Let's see here. So there's their podcast right there. So go and subscribe and check out their podcast. I think that when it comes to subjects like cancer and, what I've been talking to you guys about with my CRP and all these things, there are little adjustments. So I was talking to a guy that messaged me after the CRP episode, and we're talking about, you know, he feels a little stuck in life and all these things. And we're going back and forth. We went back and forth on Facebook Messenger for like days. And one thing I said to him, I said, probably the best thing I ever adopted into my life was try to move 1% a day, 1% in the direction you want to go a day. After 100 days, you'll be at 100% better than you were 100 days before. Right. And so even if you're not sick right now, everybody gets sick. You know that. I know that. So what can you do? What's the 1% you can move the needle today to make yourself a little healthier? Right. We all know, come on. You know the habits you have that you shouldn't have, right? You guys know my biggest struggle in life is salt and vinegar Ruffles. Thank God they're not available at all the stores. They're available at very few stores. I love the shit out of those chips. And I know, so I've been slowly but surely cutting those out, right? But with a lot of things that are bad for us that we do, we know they're bad. We still do them. Start moving in the direction of doing a little bit better every day. And don't wait until you get cancer, until your CRP levels flare up, or whatever the condition is. You can start preventing now, so that when you do end up in allopathic care, like I ended up, and the doctor looks at your test and says, wow, you're actually really healthy except for this thing, supplements probably saved your life, or exercise probably saved your life, or whatever it is. There's a lot of little things you can do. So just don't wait until you get sick. Because you're going to get sick at some point. You might as well start today and do everything you can to make yourself feel better. And baby steps. Try to do everything at once. It'll all fall apart. Baby steps will get you through. All right. So that is it. That is all for this edition of Better. Thank you so much for checking out part one and part two with Becky and Ashley. And go check out their podcast. All right. Subscribe. See you guys later. Peace.
Thanks for checking out Better. If you got to the end, it must mean you liked the episode, right? So how about 5 stars? Maybe a sub, maybe a share. Great universal combo points. And good luck on your better journey.